STI 740. We're in Las Vegas at TMT, and today we have Nominique. We actually interviewed him yesterday, and now I just want to start off by asking, what was it like when you were growing up and you had to fish for crabs?
That was rough. I wish we was fishing for crabs. It was crawfish. That's less meat than a crab, you know. But it wasn't. You know, it's kind of weird. You know, looking at things in retrospect, you look at like being older now and looking at that retrospect, I realize, damn, that's how hungry we were. But when it was actually happening.
I've been fighting in MMA for 11 years now, fighting a good fight and chasing an unobtainable.
You put the string, you put the baloney, and it was just a game to us, you know, and you didn't realize how bad it actually was. Even though you realized it was bad, it was still like, you didn't understand the gravity of it until you get older, being like, man, it's that bad.
So if you
weren't
boxing, what would you do?
I would do a lot of stuff. I used to actually do work for Foster City, you know, doing some narcotics, and then not doing the narcotics, but, you know, working for that part of the forest with Dr. Dave Barsante, and then, you know, I got me a small stint with DreamWorks. I was doing some freelance drawing for them, so I'm not sure, you know, because I'm good at a lot of different things, and things tend to catch my interest and lose my interest. I like to, I guess I'm a wanderlust. I like to go around and involve myself in multiple, you know, endeavors. But it would be something that either involved helping people or helping animals. You know, animals. My house is like a zoo, so.
You said that you were trying to be a cop. So if I didn't tell us about that.
Yeah, I was. I tried out for Foster City PD, did that, and then I was doing some stints with the narcotics team, and I ended up only being there about 6 months, you know, 7 months, because Foster City has a lot of rich people, which I didn't know at the time. It has a very high suicide rate, which I also didn't know at the time. You know, if you grow up poor, you look at all the rich people, like, they don't have any problems, but then as you get to as you get older and start to really look into it, from a social standpoint, suicide is most common amongst richer, upper class people, you know, so it shows you money doesn't, it really doesn't bring happiness. But we ended up going into a house, and it was dark, and something hit my forehead. I'm like, whoa, what the hell hit my forehead? And when we turned on the lights, it was a young kid that hung himself, and it was his feet that hit my forehead. And then, it just kept bothering me over and over every night. I was like, I'm not doing this, you know, so that's why I got out of it.
So how did you overcome that?
You just got to, I was always taught you to move on step by step, you know. There's a quote that says people should not be ruled by their memories, meaning that if you linger or harbor the past, it destroys the present. If you destroy the present, you destroy the future, you know, so always just try to move on day by day, step by step. And of course, you have to kind of look towards the future to have a goal, you know, to the end of the race, but you can never look backwards. Because, you know, even if a dog is chasing you, you look backwards, you can't run as fast looking backwards. It's just going to get closer and catch up to you. You know, so I always keep my eyes on the road.
So, you said that as a kid, you used to read a lot.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, it was weird. Even as a kid, I was kind of an introvert, and I didn't have too much faith in society in general. Even as a kid, I had a fair grasp on things most kids don't, because I was forced to be an adult as a kid, you know, and so I tended to wander off by myself and disassociate myself with people, because my family, I was like, it was a lot of gangs, alcohol, drugs, you know, so I'm like, so I would just take books and hide. Same thing, but I added two more roads into that.
Tell us about your career and what's your expectation on your career?
My career, I started boxing first, you know, and I did eight fights in boxing, eight amateur fights, and I went 8-0 with 8 knockouts. And then I was just like, I hurt my neck with a bad car accident syndrome. Girls hit me. So it was about 7 years of my life that I was in there every day, and not like figure of speech and limb. And my left arm didn't work at all. Like, I could barely hold it up or do anything. The doctor was shocked. I couldn't do anything at all, but I toughed it through. So I ended up, because of that, I was like, I need to kick boxing. And because I have more weapons, and I could hide the fact my arm is hurt. So I did kickboxing. I did about, 24 fights, I think, and went 23-1, and like 20 knockouts. So that was cool, but kickboxing hurts. And then I've always been in martial arts, Bruce Lee, Jackie Chan, Jet Li, Donnie Yen, just all that. And in MMA, I always watched it. And I ended up getting into it by a guy was beating up his girlfriend at a party. And I helped them out. And somebody was like, hey, come to a gym. And I went to the gym and did real well. And ended up going with one of the best fighters in the world, one of the best trainers in the world, for like 40 minutes before he beat me in training. And he was like, hey, you can come to that. So I kept going back because he choked me in front of my friend. And I just fell in love with it. So I switched from boxing, kickboxing, to MMA. And I just kept going forward since then. And I had real high success with basically one arm until about 2 years ago. I finally got the surgery, saved up a lot of money to get, you know, I had spine surgery here and on the back, two surgeries, used up all my savings getting fixed. And I kept beating, you know, champions from Japan, champions from America, UFC guys, that's one big tournaments, everything. And I was like, man, I'm beating these guys with one arm. Now I got two, so, and then I just fought a guy, another UFC guy that won the Ultimate Fighter Season 2, and Sugar Shane Mosley went into MMA now, and it was his first show pay-per-view. I was a main event for the belt, and then I ended up beating that guy, and then my manager got in talks with UFC and everything, so that's the next step right now. And, you know, I came right here to Vegas because another thing, well, I have a huge fan base. I got my fan base, you know, everybody loves the underdog. And people found out about my arm, like, man, he was doing this with one arm, so I got a lot of fans from that. And then they found out that I had no trainers. I was training myself. I had, like, DVDs, my girlfriend, and, like, one friend, you know. And I was training myself with that and going all around the Bay Area and across the U.S. sparring. And when the fans found that out, they were like, dude, this guy is beating these people, training himself and with one arm, and I just blew up. Plus, I connect to the people real well because I'm myself. And I was like, I can't, you know, now I can't keep doing this alone. And I came over here to TMT, they worked with me in open arms, and I hooked up with Curtis Pendleton Jr., that's my trainer. And, you know, he hooked up with a guy who used to train in Dewey Cooper when I did kickboxing, so that's my kickboxing coach. And, you know, Steve and Uncle John showed everybody, all the fellow Tim T fighters that took me with open arms. So it's the first time in my whole career, right when I was getting to like from star to superstar transition, that I actually have people behind me, so I got with them at the right time. If I want people to know anything about me or gather anything about me, it's don't make excuses for things. You know, I feel like people nowadays, that they're entitled, they want everything to be given to them, they feel like everything is owed to them, they blame their failed relationships on other people, they don't look at anything as if they did it. And I want people to look at me, and if people watch my career or my interviews or anything, I've always taken fault for any misstep I've had. I've always owned up for any responsibility of anything I've done right in my life or wrong. I've never treated anybody wrong in my life. You know, I've always, everybody knows me as a selfless individual. You know, I came to this gym, nobody knew me, and it was guys like, hey, you know, I'm looking for a job, and I hooked them up at jobs because I know people here, you know, and I didn't even know these guys at the time. There were people here who couldn't afford gear, and I gave them gear because I have a ton from a sponsor at my house. I give guys here supplements from a sponsor. I have an you know, I think people, they misconstrue what life is about, you know, and they think that it's about, like, me, money, you know, car and shoes, and it's not. It's about finding good, genuine people and going through life's journey with those people to the end, because you can't take any of the material with you. And, you know, I could be far ahead in life. You know, I went to a great school. I went to Duke. I went to a great high school, a high academic high school called Lowell. And if I left everybody behind, I could be so much further ahead. But the top of the mountain is lonely at the top, especially if you're trying to go up there alone. And it's better to hike slowly with everybody than fast and alone. You know, and I want people to see me and have an idea of how to do things the right way, and that is about, it's about us and we, not me and I, and that's what I want people to get from me.
So how did you go to these good schools while you were living in poverty?
You work your butt off, and that's all it is. I always did good academically. I always did good academically. So I always had the school taken care of, you know. I don't even feel education shit costs. It's a setup to, like, be educated to get these great jobs. But if you're not smart enough to get a scholarship, we're gonna charge you so much money that you can't go. And then if we don't charge you that money, we'll give you a deal on it where we'll let you in, get the education, but you're gonna be paying us back forever. It's all a setup. It's backwards. They set you up like that, but I was fortunate enough to just get in and have everything taken care of, so that's how I ended up doing it. Study your butt off, man. Hard work make easy work in the end, you know? Hard work make easy work, you know?
Well, Dominique, it's always good to have you on our show. Like you said, hard work is easy work. Can't end it better than that.
Thanks for having me, and it's at PhoneManager510 on Twitter and Instagram.
Say it again.
At FallenAngel510, Twitter, Instagram, me, all my goon squad on there. So at FallenAngel510 on Twitter and Instagram.